All right, thank you. Thank you, everybody, for coming here. We really appreciate it. This is, I think, going to be an interesting presentation for the malware folks at the tactical level. You know, the kinds of things that you might see in terms of deception, right, or in terms of the applied to attribution, both at the tactical level, but then at the strategic level. And as we all know, I think, you know, the number of cyber war skeptics is sort of getting smaller every year. And we've seen in Ukraine, in Estonia, where I've lived, as well as Latvia, where Carlos lives, and now in Washington, D.C., with the, of course, the 2016 election, this kind of stuff is important. So a little bit what we're going to talk about is how you can take malware and steal it and use it for your own purposes. And I'll pass it off to Carlos.
Yes. Hello, I'm Carlos. I'm a threat analyst with CERT. And our talk is the inspiration. Our reasoning is if you're looking in the recent diplomatic relations between the United States and North Korea. So the official statements have been that Kim Jong-un is short and fat, that was tweeted by Donald Trump, and that in response, the North Korean official outlets called Donald Trump a cockroach. So let's look into the cockroaches, because it will lead into the real topic of our discussion. So what's a cockroach? So Periplaneta americana, the American cockroach, there are many different aspects to it. So first of all, you can see that it's like a disgusting creature, right? At least in the Western world. In Southeast Asia, that's a source of protein, and it is very likely to be the highest life form that survives if Mr. Trump and Mr. Kim move from words to action and start like a nuclear holocaust. So that's about cockroaches. And let's move over to malware samples. So our philosophy is that there must be something more to malware. And let's look at malware from a different aspect and treat it as a resource. So for a common user, it's like if they see a malware sample, they either panic or like delete it or don't report it to anybody and hope that it will go away or something. So for you guys in the audience, and for me, it's mostly to be analyzed and to derive some IOCs from it, some indicators of compromise. And but for a resource-strapped economy like North Korea or any other smaller country or organization, it is a highly complex software delivered to your inbox daily, free of charge. So you can try to, can you make use of it? Can you reuse the malware? The short answer is yes. We'll show how it can be done and what are the strategic implications of that.
So this is not just us dreaming this up. These are actually quotes. You know, one of them is a Snowden quote, so I can't confirm it. But the top one is actually the head of DIA, the Defense Intelligence Agency, who basically told a large conference of national security professionals in Washington, once we've isolated malware, we want to reuse it. We want to re-weaponize it and throw it back at the originating party. Right, and then among the WikiLeaks dump from Snowden was that in the wild, malware does indeed form a basis for APT or nation-state malware, because you know you might find something that's cool and want to re-weaponize and repurpose it.
Okay, so who am I? I'm a threat analyst with CERT.LV. That is not the CERT of Las Vegas. That's the CERT of Latvia. So a small country on the eastern side of Europe. And I have heard that you have had some issues with Russia and hacking lately. So, welcome to the club. We have issues with Russia for basically more than a millennia. We are basically the border of Western civilization and Eastern civilization. since that's like a map of probably like 11 or 1200. So so that's we're the national cert. We deal everything cyber incident related in Latvia. And you know, when I come to US, you have many kinds of funny things written on walls and stuff. And one of that is if you see something, say something. So that's basically my message to the security community. If you see something that is happening in Latvia, say it to us. It will be mutually beneficial. It's very great to read that, you know, this and that APT was hosted in Latvia like 3 months ago, but it's not really actionable. If you come to us like in advance, as you have that information, we can work together and we can like share some stuff back with you. So yeah, please do so.
So a lot of you are probably familiar with Winston Churchill's quote that Russia is a mystery wrapped in a puzzle inside an enigma. But I would say it's rather the opposite. Just like George Kennan wrote at the end of World War II, actually Russia is quite straightforward. And if you look at the body of cyber attack literature, it's probably the healthiest, right, overall. If you go to the cuckoo's egg in the 80s, Moonlight Maze in the 90s, Estonia in 2007, Ukraine in 2014, Washington DC in 2016, it's quite a long history of fancy bear, you name it bear, right? And so, in fact, according to CrowdStrike, if you remember, they said that both the FSB and the GRU, two different intel organizations, were both inside the DNC, but neither one knew the other was there, right? So that's the space. And attribution is a big deal in cyber attacks because it's very hard to understand the nature of the new domain. So not only do we have a cyber command in the United States, but NATO as well has declared that all of the cyber space of NATO countries, which is 29 sovereign countries, is a domain of warfare.
All right. So. Now I'll describe the case study, which was basically a fun side project that I did when I was just too bored with just analyzing the Russian malware. Okay, it might be Russian malware. They have not confirmed that it's Russian, but like the security community says so. So it's a real world sample that was caught in wild in 2017. It was like a European-wide spear phishing case from an APT actor to a carefully selected targets. So who has recently, and it had like 2 zero days in it. So who has recently received email with 2 zero days? Can you like show? And 1 zero day. Huh, I guess you're not like that high on the target lists of APTs, maybe, I don't know. But yeah, well, it's nice to get an email with 2 zero days in it. It's like fun to read. That's your.
Yeah, so, you know, malware. One of the ways you can think about it sort of anatomically or architecturally is it's kind of like a Russian nesting doll, right? It's got layers to it, and you can replace these layers once you catch it and you contain it. You can reverse engineer it, and you can replace. And the two things we're going to talk about in this particular talk are replacing either the payload or the command and control infrastructure. But you can do either one. And basically, then you've caught a weapon and you've repurposed it, right? It's kind of like catching an F-16 or maybe an AK-47, but being able to reload it and reuse it. And you may find that different layers are written by different people for different purposes. And once you get into the center, the actual owner of a particular operation could be someone else. For example, you know, 15 years ago, I was at the Pentagon, and we were so obsessed with Chinese hackers I'm sure that there were many other nations actually hacking the Pentagon through China, right? It would just have been too easy, basically, because of the over reaction against one particular country.
Okay, so basically now I give you a short technical intro in how to read email the proper way. I got this Word document, and docx, so it's just a zip container. So the Word part, the document part, looked benign, and there was just a single image file in the directory structure once you unzip it. So, well, you anyway always look at the images first, right? That's what I did. It turned out to be an embedded PostScript file, or enhanced PostScript file, I'm not sure. But basically, like, it's not a bitmap, it's some PostScript code that would generate some image. So let's look at it. 700 kilobytes of stuff, and it was like 99% hex garbage. So if you see here, so this was like the 1% of readable stuff, and then it was like lots and lots of hex garbage. You don't have to be an expert in PostScript, although I like started reading the PostScript manual. It's a little bit interesting way to program stuff, but just like look at the things which are colored red. So a short hex part, then XR, and then a long hex part. So it doesn't take much skill just to figure it out. Well, maybe it's an XR cipher, and well, it was an XR cipher. So I'm able to get past the first hurdle to get in the second layer of the doll. Then I did like what I like to call like high level analysis. And just zoom out. Maybe it's not so easy to see, but like you can see patterns here. So here is some things, and there's something else, and then there's something else here again. So it turns out that basically this is exploit for this Microsoft EPS image processing thing, and that's just shell code. Like if you could see, it would be 558BEC, which is basically how you build up a frame in assembly. Don't get lost in the details. Don't try to read and interpret every single thing, trying to spot the pattern, and it took me where I wanted to be. Further on, I don't want to like kill you with too many technical details on malware analysis and reverse engineering, but basically just going like layer after layer of such analysis, I solved the puzzle. So basically, on the outside, you see there's a Word document, a zip archive, so you can just zip and unzip it with common tools. Any zip tool will do it. Then there is this outer PostScript image, and that contains some more PostScript that was encrypted with XR cipher. Then we saw in that PostScript there was a PostScript exploit and the shellcode, the outer shellcode. Well, that shellcode turned out to be packed, so I got to the inner part, which is basically encrypted with a probable pseudo-random number generator. Looking in there, it was easy to spot executables. So just like search for strings and see like this program is not designed to run in MS-DOS mode. So nice feature. So there's this dropper executable, which contains escalation of privilege exploits for 32 and 64 bit windows respectively. And inside that dropper, there is the payload, right? The thing that will be installed in your system once it's infected. So the payload was encrypted, and it was also zip compressed. And in there, like very deep down below, there was this command and control string, the domain that is where the malware calls home, which is also additionally encrypted. So, well, all of those cryptographic methods used were not kind of like state of the art or something, but it's good enough to take the casual analyst to keep it entertained. So during this analysis, I had to like defeat several layers of obfuscation. So there are several ways how you can do it. Like if it's a known algorithm, you just like Google for it and download some Python implementation or something. So we did that for like zip or something. I didn't write my own zip, unzip stuff. You can, if you see some homebrew code you don't know, then you can just re-implement it with IDA and hex arrays. It's like this decompiling functionality works pretty well. You get like a garbage C code, and I could like easily write a Python implementation for some custom crypto things the guys have implemented. And I think the most fun thing was basically like a similar to like one-time pad generating. So since you have a like a malware sample, so it works. You can run it. So I just replaced the buffer, the ciphertext buffer, with zeros. Let it run, and then I dumped the output buffer, and it's basically like a one-time pad. Once you get this output buffer, you can XOR it with like your plain text, and you will get like a proper ciphertext once you want to reuse and go do this analysis in backwards. So yeah, sometimes it's nice because a sample is like a real thing. You can just let the processor run it in a controlled environment in a debugger. Basically, what I have shown you is I try to convince you that it is possible to analyze an APT sample in great detail, to be able to steal that malware and repurpose for my needs. That's like the last mile is to have to re-implement the command and control protocol. So I have the ability to change the malware executable so that it calls home to a domain I specify, but I still need the server side part to be able to remotely control that infected box. And we didn't do this, but we estimate that it shouldn't be too complicated because you can see basically the command and control protocol here. You have like, here it's like compares a string with delete, load lib, read file. So basically you have the client side in a running state, and you can just like experiment and develop the server side. It shouldn't be that difficult, so any decent programmer could do it in a few days. So overall, like you can once you have carefully disassembled or analyzed all this Russian doll thing, you can carefully put it back together with some minor modifications that make my major change. So you can just swap out the shellcode with your shellcode, and then you basically steal the EPS exploit. You can go deeper. You can replace the dropper executable with like new custom dropper or whatever you prefer to have. Then you also steal the escalation of privilege exploit. And if you want to be like really fancy, you can you can replace just the command and control domain name with the one you like. And then it's like, should be like super stealthy or super false flag, because, well, there is no difference in that really makes apart once the original sample from new sample. There might be some like minor, super minor things like how the zip compression is like performed. There might be some minor changes there, but it's like very difficult to tell apart. So basically, somebody else's malware is gone in 60 seconds. We wrote it up in a nice and short Python code. So basically, just supply the new command and control domain, and it produces a new sample. And here below, you can see the Wireshark output that it connects home to the new domains that we specified. Just to take a sip of water. So yes, there are different choices of how complex you want to be. Like the sooner or on a higher level you do the replacement, it is less technically complicated, but it's also it's less of a false flag thing. So you can replace a shell code, you can replace a payload. It's more complicated, but gives you better option. And like the perfect crime, or I don't know, perfect thing is replacing CNC. So it's most complicated, but not really that complicated, and gives you like as much false flag capability as you can get. So
the acronym APT you're probably familiar with, and I think one of the best ways to think about it is as a synonym for a nation state intelligence bureaucracy, right? And that's what sets the nation apart from everybody else, especially the lone hacker, but also even the hacker collective. They just don't have that team mission-oriented approach. So in 2010, Carlos and I, we were at NATO then, we brought over Charlie Miller to talk about how you, and we asked him, he said, I'm at the bit level, so what can I do? We said, oh, you can help a lot. He said, tell us how you would build a hacker army if you were advising North Korea, right? And so he gave a killer presentation in Europe that then he subsequently gave at DEF CON a couple of months later. And in it, not only did he dress up in fatigues, which was fun, but he explained how he would want about, I think he said, $45 million a year to have his own personal APT. But when we looked at those numbers, the most expensive part of it was vulnerability discovery and exploit development. And so that's essentially what Carlos and I now are suggesting you can get for close to free, right? That's what you're stealing from somebody else, is the identification of vulnerabilities and the exploit against it, right? The other things are cheaper, you know, the human guy or the management personnel. And so it's the most expensive tech talent, essentially, is what you can... you get a discount on with malware theft. So now I want to jump up a little bit to the strategic layer. The impact for the decision maker at the level of national security, if you're sitting in the White House, for example, these are some of the things that malware theft and the increased complexity associated with it would give you. Imagine you're sitting in the Oval Office. So there's arms control, right? Which is one of the primary ways in international relations that we seek to reduce the level of violence and the level of conflict in the system. But here we have a situation in which cyber weapons would seem to are going to proliferate at a higher rate. And so that more parties, there'll be more players on the battlefield, more campaigns, more attacks, and it's going to be more difficult to attribute them to a particular party, right? And so the best example we have so far, I think, is the shadow brokers and the NotPetya attack, for example, against Ukraine, which uses Eternal Blue, which is stolen from the NSA, which appears to be a cover operation for something else. And just yesterday, I don't know if you saw this in the New York Times, but the US and UK announced that Russia was up to something in cyberspace and that there's a pending attack. They had seen indicators of Russian activity on the core internet infrastructure. Well, I would suggest that could easily be a deception operation, just a narrative controlling. Yeah, it might be Russian actors and it might be Russian signatures, but the problem in cyberspace is most of cyber war happens in peacetime, which increases the fog of war, right? And so these things that you have to worry about if you're a national security decision maker. So national security is mostly a subjective thing. Right? Is it a national security threat? You know, did Estonia in 2007 come under attack, and should NATO have responded? You know, these are subjective questions. You know, you get skeptics who say that's ridiculous. You know, you get others who say, well, what if you put all of the government services online and then they're taken away from you? How can the government, you know, interact with the people, et cetera? And so they view that as a national security threat. But that is, at the end of the day, subjective. If we get toward the bottom here, from false flags into diplomacy, I think that actually this is a really interesting space to explore. Diplomats are, after all, one of the primary targets for cyber espionage. They are also those who would negotiate international treaties to limit the use of the existence of cyber weapons, the use of cyber weapons, and their mitigation. But there's all kinds of miscalculation that will be involved with tools. And one of the things we want to suggest in this presentation is it might be relatively easy to steal a good cyber weapon, but using it, you might get in trouble, right? Because, again, you might not have the political and military strategic depth to deal with retaliation. Ooh. Okay, so one of the things as a decision maker is at least to think about the loss of a strategic asset. So in the case, now we knew that doxing, for example, could destroy an individual. Then we knew that doxing could destroy a company. Right? And so it's harder to destroy a government, but we've seen just as a person can be doxed and a firm, so can the NSA and the CIA, both of whom have been doxed, right, over the past year or two, and classified information released in even cyber tools, right? The DNC, most famous example so far of having been doxed, but at the decision-making level, the national security level, you're not running a cyber operation, but potentially you're giving it to the world, right? If somebody catches it, reverses engineer, then they've got their own weapon that they can use against you. And of course, it appears that the Russians are getting no end of fun out of this by employing, for example, Eternal Blue within the Ukrainian context.
So, yeah, I think when you're planning a cyber operation, you have to take into consideration the second degree outcomes. Let's say when Stuxnet was used against Iran, the Iranians could have reverse engineered it and they likely did it, and they could go after all the Siemens devices in the world. But it seems that they're rational enough not to do it. But if you would attack something like ISIS with a malware that is too potent, then you might get into trouble because all it takes is a few smart guys that would change it and, I don't know, replace it with a wiper and wipe the internet away as we know it. So yeah.
That's exactly right. I mean, if you think about the power of a wiper, right, against a company, then powerful exploit plus just a a change in intention, right? Not to not to steal information for cyber espionage, but just to destroy it for a terrorist purpose or against a rival.
Yeah, exactly. Like doing a fully fledged cyber operations. It's hard. It's only for the nation states or well wealthy corporations or something. But like stealing that malware or repurposing it and doing like going out for maximum damage, that's pretty easy. Like it's within capabilities of like organized terrorists or something.
So in this summary is that it's faster and easier than one might imagine to build an arsenal of cyber tools. And I think for the offensive side, it gives not only more possibilities in attack, but for the defensive side, it increases the challenges in cyberspace. So I think for both of them, it kind of gives them pause and patience over should be overreaction or quick reaction in this sense, because it is going to lead to complexities, I think, on the cyber battlefield as tools get out and repurposed.
So you have to get away from the tools-based attribution, so that it is like this family of malware, so it must be like Chinese or Russians or whomever. No, it might be like anybody, so you have to move over to tactics, techniques, procedures based attribution, which is way harder, and also what is a takeaway for intel agencies is that I fully agree that they can catch the malware, repurpose or modify it, but the hard question is whom to attack. Because it's easy to do the catching and repurposing, what was quoted by the DIA chief, but whom to attack back, that's a hard question that not answered.
Yeah, and you're really going to need on defense, I think, strategic data sets and a holistic approach to attribution, right? And that's why I think the best attribution is only done after a year or two's worth of data collection and analysis, so that you can times and signatures and languages and search terms and in C2 and actually the traditional gumshoe approach as well to investigations. Right, you can only get so much from computer log files, but you also have to talk to people and allies, etc. So attribution will take more time and effort. So I think this is our final slide. It's just the apply. And Carlos, I'm sure, has more specific things on the technical side that he could suggest. But from my perspective, it's a matter of awareness up front on both sides. If you have an offensive team, you have to be aware that somebody might steal your tools, right? And so you have to be more judicious in your choice of operation and your the risk factor of losing your tools, right? And over time, you might come up with something like digital rights management for your toolbox, right? How do you keep control of and track the important tools you have? It's a very good question. Because, as you know, most advanced players, actors in cyberspace, they're out on the internet, and they're going to have drop sites for exfil and tools and buffer zones between them and adversaries. And it takes time to sort through all that stuff, but there is no way for an offense not to be active out on the open internet where tools can be stolen. And so that's just part of the overall risk. On the defensive side, I think it's a matter of first awareness and then thinking about that what you see as may not be what is reality. And then over time, trying to build a sophisticated library of information, tools, tactics, and procedures, just like the professionals do it. And it took the Pentagon so many years to get right, You know, in the 80s and 90s, I think it really was a huge question about who was attacking. Less so now that attribution is a professional discipline. We still have the question on the national security side about what to do about cyber attacks. Because since most of them kind of fly under the radar of what the military calls use of force, it's really hard to know how to respond to them. But I think as far as the network defense side goes, it's a knowledge that the game is hard and you have to collaborate and communicate.
Yeah, and maybe also like we have this like offense, defense, and it should also be like a column for DIA. So I think they should come up with like a more scary thing to quote. Like if I can do the same thing in a few weeks as they are like threatening the world with, it's like not very credible. So yeah, it's really, really easy. It didn't take a lot of time. It was good fun. And yeah, thank you for
thank you for your attendance. We're happy to take any questions, either now or after the talk, but we really appreciate it.
Yeah, so, you call that the ERM as a possibility. The example that you showed, it didn't look like they invested very much in like trying to keep this tamper-proof. So just as a broad idea of all the samples that come across your desk, is that something that you see authors investing in, or just mostly the malware industry not care?
Well, okay, so the question is the sample that we provided didn't seem to have a lot of in the way of protection. How would you assess that?
Yes, so you're right. So I haven't seen like real investment in trying to like defend. It's mostly like some obfuscation techniques to hamper the analysis. But you can get over them, and there is no I don't know certificate based things or what. I mean, it will be. I don't know if it is possible to build a malware that is like only that is impossible to steal. But you might it would be quite easy to add some public-private key stuff that you assign your malware with your secret key, and then at least like if somebody else steals it, then they can replace. They have to like sign it with some other key. They don't have access to that key. So you can, and if you like do it as a routine, as a procedure, then that would give some credibility so that you can really say, well, that was really not us, or I don't know. So that you see that's some other actor. They're still running the same malware, but it must be somebody else. But it's like, I don't know how like it's very unlikely that it's a possibility. But I think like that all the cyber operators are on offensive side, they should think about this because it's very likely to become a problem in the future if it's not a problem already.
Thank you. Another answer, I have a good friend and he studies Chinese intrusions. And he said that the majority of, he's a really world-class expert, and says that the majority he looks at are simply very bad at operational security. They're not trying that hard because first, most people aren't looking, and two, there's nothing you can do about it, right? As far as operational security around something like Stuxnet, for example, that really may represent the minority of attacks, which would mean that many more of them are open to being captured and repurposed.
Well, if just to add to this, like it's like a pyramid here of skills, right? You have like vulnerability discovery guys and exploit development, which is like super rare talent, and you pay them well, and like they know what they're doing. But then on the bottom part, you have like mouse operators who just point and click, and so those are the most difficult to teach about security or well teach about anything. So that's always there this trade-off or different skills.
It's work. Okay. Don't you think that you overestimate the potential, the maturity of cyber weapons? Because what I demonstrate now, it's a classical APT that we saw started from 2 to 8. And if we talk about the industrial cybersecurity field, the problem of industrial cybersecurity, including Stuxnet, is that industrial field under shifting from parallel protocols to Ethernet-based era. And they, for today, stepping into the new era with new potential risks and try to adopt to them. Because for today, the infrastructure that can protect the world, that protect the companies from such kind of attacks is already on the field. If you talk about the antivirus systems, Kaspersky, McAfee, Symantec provide the excellent technologies that can protect you from such kind of threats. That's it's very interesting. What do you think about the overestimation of buzzwording the cyber weapons?
I mean, like, I could do it in like a week, not doing it full time. So if you have a decent team of people who can work full time or 24/7, you can, or like you can probably next time you can, I can do it in a day, and next time I can do it in 2 hours or so. So even like as good Kaspersky and McAfee are, they're not likely to identify those threats in a few hours. If you're like one of the few first persons in the world who are targeted, right? If it's like in a wild for a long time, then yeah, you'll be covered. If you're the first guy who is targeted, good luck with that. And then if I can like re-weaponize that thing in a few hours, all I need is to get in, right? If my operators and attack infrastructure and management is like fully functional already and ready, you know, you just drop the new sample in and then go out and do your thing. Or like if you want to like just destroy lots of computers of innocent civilians or whatever, the whole world as they are, just like, you know, replace this payload with a wiper and go out and just cause lots of damage if you just hate the civilization or something. It's pretty likely. I don't know like about industrial control systems. Some say that like they're like super protected, and some say that they still run on Windows 95. I'm not an expert in that, so I would not like to comment. But I mean that there is this speed and momentum that you can use. If you like do this in 3 months, yeah, well, you'll be protected. But if you do it in 3 hours, I don't know what the chances are. Well, it's worth to try if you're an attacker, in my opinion.
Any more questions? Anyone? Thank you very much for your attendance. I appreciate it.
Thank you.
Thanks.